chapter 10, verse 2. And Dave, just cut this out so I'm not in and out, and I'll just use my voice, okay? So, okay.
This is the word of God. He who receives you receives me, and he who receives me receives the one who sent me. Anyone who receives a prophet because he is a prophet will receive a prophet's reward. And anyone who receives a righteous man because he is a righteous man will receive a righteous man's reward. And if anyone comes, gives even a cup of cold water to one of these little ones, because he is my disciple, I tell you the truth, he will certainly not lose his reward. Here ends the reading of God's holy word. May it bless you all that have ears to hear. Will you sit down? I have to tell this story. The welcome back was not my first. That was not my first time that I had told that story to a bunch of kids. The last time I did it was about 3 years ago in McMahon. And I had this group of children up front, and I told them the story about the welcome mat, and I got about three quarters of the way done, and one of the little boys raised his hand. I said, yes. And he goes, there isn't a welcome mat outside of our church. And it was true. There was no welcome that day. But guess what there was next week? See, our scripture today begins by that, welcoming, and what that means to welcome. We open our homes with a welcome mat and say, come on in, wipe your feet, then come on in. But we as a church also have to do that. To have a welcome mat, per se, that we can be a place where anyone is welcome, that anyone can walk off the street and come into this house and feel like they're a part of us. Because Matthew begins his story by saying, ye who welcome, those who welcome you welcome me, and the one who sent. But before we get to that, we have to back up just a little bit, because if you're following along in the Bible as I was reading that, chapter 10 ends with 40 to 42. So that means that essentially, I have to assume that either you know the beginning of the story, or at least make sure that you have an idea of what's happening. So I'm going to let you in on maybe what was happening. This story that Matthew tells in chapter 10 is the other bookend from chapter 7. Chapter 7 was one of Jesus' most famous sermons, the Sermon on the Mount. And in between chapter 7 and chapter 10, he places 8 and 9. In these two chapters, he delivers the message of Jesus, the miracles that he was doing, and healings that were taking place. So Matthew is telling the story of what Jesus had to offer. That love, that caring, forgiveness. And at the end of chapter 9, he changes his tone just a bit. And he says this, Jesus looks at the crowds and has compassion on them because they are harassed and helpless, like sheep without a shepherd. So he tells his disciples, the harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Therefore, ask the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into his harvest. That's chapter 9, verses 37 and 38. And obviously, Jesus had in mind that the disciples would be the answer to their own question or their own prayer.
Because at the very beginning of chapter 10, Jesus sends the 12 out. Jesus gives those 12 disciples the same power that he had. They could heal. They could forgive. All those things that Jesus could do, the disciples could do. And Jesus sends them out into the world. But Jesus says this: if you're going to participate in my power, if you're going to participate in my healing, if you're going to do that part of my ministry, then you got to do this part of my ministry too. Did Jesus have a home? Did he have a home? No, he did not have a home. He was homeless. Did he have a paying job? No, he was penniless. He depended upon the hospitality of others to provide what was needed. So Jesus says, you're going out. You're going out to do the things that I can do, but you're also going to do, you're going to take what I took with me, nothing. Don't take an extra pair of sandals or a tunic. Don't take any money with you, because you're going to depend upon those people that will receive you. Because those that receive you receive me, and those who receive me receive God. See how that works? And so they said no. Jesus knows they're not going to be welcomed everywhere. Jesus knows that he's going to get the reception that he did in some places. Jesus knows that they'll be persecuted. Jesus knows they'll be rejected. Jesus knows that there are going to be days that they're going to wonder why they're even doing this. And Jesus says, hang on. Hang in there. Because I got your back. Remember that from last week? Jesus is always there. Jesus says, I'll be with you to the end of time. Whoever welcomes you welcomes me. And whoever welcomes me welcomes the one who sent me, my Father God. This idea of welcoming in the ancient world was very important. Because if you welcome someone into your home, you not only were welcoming that person, but the person's family as well. The people from where they came from. You were saying, you're all welcome. Come on in. We're supposed to be like that. Our doors should be open. The welcome mat should be put out. Doesn't matter who you are, what you have, what you don't have, you're welcome. But that's kind of scary, isn't it? But I can see you, but I don't know what your family's like. How many of you have crazy families? No lie. There's some that maybe I don't want to. But Jesus says, welcome, because you welcome me. So that idea of radical hospitality is when you welcome the stranger into your home. Whoever welcomes the disciples into their homes, they receive the very presence of Jesus. I want you to think about that this morning as we approach the communion table. We receive Jesus. And then Jesus wants us to welcome others. Jesus continues saying, whoever welcomes a prophet in the name of a prophet will receive a prophet's reward, and whoever welcomes a righteous person in the name of a righteous person will receive the reward of the righteous. Who's confused? Let me read it again, see if it helps you. Whoever welcomes a prophet in the name of a prophet will receive a prophet's reward. And whoever welcomes a righteous man in the name of a righteous person will receive the reward of the righteous. Now we're not sure if Matthew is delineating or creating two different groups, prophets and righteous persons, and it really doesn't matter, because essentially what we're talking about here are those that are sent. If we talk about a prophet, God sends them to people to tell God's message to whomever it was. A righteous person has his obedience to God and is in the will of God. But what do we know about the prophets? In Matthew's text, in Matthew's story, the words prophet and righteous are used often. But they can refer to those in the Old Testament. What do we know about Old Testament prophets? What happened to them? They were rejected. Most of them were stoned. Most of them died because the person they were telling us their God's story to didn't like that. How many of you want a prophet's reward? But yet, they were called to be a prophet, and they were being in God's will, and in so doing, received the true reward. That being with God. That gift of eternal life. We think about, what is righteous mean? We are told that Abraham was considered righteous because of his belief in God. And because of that, Matthew says that the righteous will receive a shining in heaven like no other. So the promise, the reward, comes later. Now it almost sounds like it's something that we can earn, isn't it? The reward, if we're a prophet, we earn it. If we are a righteous person, we can earn our reward. But in our final verse, Jesus tells us a little something different. Because Jesus says, finally, and whoever gives even a cup of cold water to one of these little ones in the name of a disciple, truly I tell you, none of these will lose their reward. Little ones, micros, often refers to children. But Matthew uses micros to represent also those that are young in their faith, young in their journey with Christ. And so Jesus is saying, anyone who gives a cup of water to those that are just beginning their journey and helping them along, this idea of serving those, a cup of water to the little ones, also gives us a glimpse of chapter 25 of Matthew, where it says, if you have given a cup of water to the least of these, have you you've given clothing to the naked, if you've given food to the hungry, if you've given money to the poor, then you have received me. So we're getting a glimpse here of what Matthew will tell us later. Because that's what we're to do. To serve. The word, I couldn't say it earlier, I like pistos, is a form of the word micros. That is translated as least of these. So Matthew is saying, not only the children, yes, they need a cup of water, but those that are young in their walk, they need a cup of water, they need nourish, they need somebody to walk with them. And those that are most vulnerable, they need you. They need you to give them a cup of water. They need you to help them in their journey. So in chapter 25, it also says, the righteous who attend the needs of the little ones are told, come, you are blessed by my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. We get this idea that the rewards of a prophet, the rewards of the righteous person can be earned. But Jesus changes that up. And it says, inherit what I have. An inheritance is a gift. An inheritance is free. Except for the tax you have to pay to the state. This idea of what Jesus has being free is in that idea that Jesus has adopted us into the very family of God by our baptism. And because we have been baptized in that, and if we are a member of that family, then all that Jesus has is free. It's a gift. Not something that we can earn. So Jesus says, give a cup of water to a little one, and your reward will never be lost. Why? Jesus has given to us freedom. All that he had. Grace, mercy, love, kindness, the list goes on. So if we receive freely, what do? We give freely. And that is our reward. Because when we receive, we give, we will have time with the Lord eternally. As eternal events. Now the one thing that Matthew assumes in this chapter is that the church is a sent church. One thing that prophets and righteous people have in common is that they are going somewhere. The prophets went to tell. Elijah went to Ahab and told him that he needed to get straightened out. Abraham was considered righteous because of his faith. And being in the will of God was led to the promised land. So Matthew's assuming that it's a sent church. And isn't that what church really should be? Oftentimes we think a church is this lovely building, a lovely group of people. But the church is not staying. The church does not stay in one place. If a church is being the church, we're being sent. Irregardless of our call. Maybe prophet. All of us are not called to wander around and depend upon others for their well-being. But nonetheless, we are called. Irregardless of our age. Irregardless of who we are. We are called to give the message of Jesus Christ, the gospel. Doesn't matter our age. I looked back here at Ethan. Had an opportunity on the TV. He was interviewed. And he says, Jesus is my best friend. What more of a testimony can you give? But somehow, it seems like as we grow older, we lose sight of what we can do. Lots of times our bodies don't do as much as they used to. Because of what happens naturally. But that doesn't get you off the hook. I'm going to tell a story I never read. I was at Savory on Thursday, and she wanted to know who in the church she could pray for that was ill or having troubles. She understands that her calling is to do what you can. And praying is not the last thing or the least thing that you can do for anyone. Jesus calls us the hands and feet to embody the good news of Jesus Christ. Sometimes we may risk rejection because of it. But God's got our back through Jesus Christ. So what does that look like these days? To be called by Jesus to embody Christ to the world. I have a video that might be able to help us understand that a little bit. David? Thank you.